Joining me live from central London is Jad Patel, the legal and policy director of the Joint Council for the Welfare of Immigrants. Also there is Douglas Murray, associate editor at The Spectator. Hello to you, Douglas, both of you, but Douglas, if I may bring you in first of all. Question to both of you, really. Douglas, to start with, how should we interpret these figures?
Well, there are all sorts of details in them, but to my mind, the most clear overriding fact of them is the demonstration once again that the government's aspiration to get net migration into the UK down from the hundreds of thousands a year to the tens of thousands, as David Cameron famously said, has been woefully missed again this year, as it has been in every year previously since he made that promise. There's also, I might add, of course, because we're in this period of EU referendum mania, also, of course, a very significant political problem here, which is that the Prime Minister and the Home Secretary, Theresa May, both of whom really one has to regard as being responsible for the migration figures, have repeatedly throughout their political careers cited the EU as being the factor in the immigration debate which stops them being able to get migration down to the levels they wish to. So now David Cameron and Theresa May have a very difficult circle to square, which is they can argue that the entity which they claim has stopped them doing what they promised the public they would do is nevertheless something we should all remain in.
Jad Patel?
Hi. Well, I think Douglas is quite right. The government has again failed to bring down net migration as they promised. But I think it's important to remember that the way that they've been approaching this is to impose more and more deeply illiberal policies that are aimed at creating a hostile environment for migrants. And I think one thing that both sides of the EU migration debate should remember is that the levels of migration we're seeing right now are very much a sign and an indication of the UK's position in a global economy where we're one of the countries that are recovering from a global recession a bit better than the countries around us. And we have a real need for workers to come here and to fill essential jobs. And it would be a real blow to the country if the government were, in fact, to succeed.
Douglas, without question, it is going to be one of the significant issues as far as the British public is concerned ahead of an EU referendum. I suppose the question would be, in your opinion, if Britain leaves the EU, what impact would that have on these migration figures?
Well, if Britain were to leave the EU, then of course all of these matters would be in the hands of the British government, whatever political stripe that government was, Conservative, Labour or anything else. If we were to leave the EU, then the sort of excuses we've heard from David Cameron and Theresa May in recent years would be totally illegitimate. Nobody could claim that we weren't responsible for our borders because we'd be the only people responsible for our borders. So to that extent, I mean, all of the challenges which the global economy and the migration crisis and all of these sort of things would still be there. None of those problems disappear if Britain were to leave the EU. But the point is the ability to actually control your own borders, to have nobody else telling you what you can and cannot do, would undoubtedly be a factor that would bring net immigration to this country down. Because after all, very quickly, it's worth remembering that that is the desire of the overwhelming majority of the British people in poll after poll and survey after survey. It is the case that the British public want migration to the UK to be brought down substantially. And governments can't keep on failing to answer the public mood.
To that end, Stephen Kay has tweeted us this afternoon, hello to you, Stephen, saying we can't take care of people born and bred here. We can't keep letting people in. No questions asked. He puts it very bluntly, but that really is a view of a significant number of people here in the United Kingdom.
Well, I think one of the issues with that is it's impossible to talk about what the people in Britain want without talking about the constant and incredibly unhelpful misleading facts that are put out in the migration debate. And I think a lot of people in the country do feel that migration should come down, but that is very much because they're constantly told by politicians like Theresa May that migrants are the reasons that their lives feel like they're not improving in the way that they would expect, and that migrants are the reasons why government policy keeps failing. And really what we've seen is decades of underinvestment in British people by the government. And what should be happening right now is the government should be developing a sensible and fair immigration policy where the benefits of migration are invested back in the communities where migrants live and in other communities so that no one is left behind in the UK.
If I could just pick up on that briefly, Kay. I mean, it is simply not the case that the British public's views on immigration are, as we often hear from the mass migration lobby and so on, are simply because, you know, we read the wrong newspapers in the morning or we watch the wrong television programs. People's views on immigration are not, in fact, caused by that. They are caused by the fact that they live in Britain, that the British people live in Britain, that they use British public services, that they use the NHS and schools, and they see enormous pressure being put on these things. And what is more, they see with their own eyes, without any evil manipulation by television producers or newspaper owners and editors, they see that the society around them is changing exceedingly rapidly, and they don't particularly like that. And that is not a fantasy, it's not a misperception. It is something which people see and which, as I say, democratic governments have to answer to.
There are two parts to that. I mean, the first on public services is that, I mean, the facts simply are that migrants are net contributors to public services in the UK, and that services like the NHS really do depend on migrant workers to maintain themselves. On the other point, which is the point around people's perceptions of migration, it is true that some people and many people in the country might well feel that, but quite often you find that those views are most prevalent in the areas where migration is at its lowest.
Several reasons for that. The study that's always wheeled out to justify this claim, by the way, is itself highly questionable, as are most studies of the kind that you just cited about migrants being net beneficiaries to the NHS and so on. In actual fact, most studies cancel each other out on that and come to the conclusion that migrants are neither a net benefit nor a net gain, in which case, why do you want to so massively change your society for something that is not a net financial gain? But to come back to the second point about people's attitudes who, as you say, live in areas that are maybe less diverse and so on, there is, of course, another explanation for that, isn't it? It isn't simply that, in actual fact, the British people who don't want mass migration at this level are all nativist, racist, knuckle-dragging idiots. Rather, it is possible that the people who do not live in the most diverse areas, as we might say, do not live in the most diverse areas because they do not want to live in the most diverse areas. In other words, not only that there is there are sections of immigrant communities that cut themselves off from the rest of society, but that much of the rest of society wants to live in areas and wants to live in communities of a kind that it recognizes. And okay. One final thought on that quickly, which is that many of the places we talk about as being diverse in Britain are far from diverse. Diverse and these sort of things have become enormous euphemisms, often for completely monocultural identities, but monocultural identities from another culture.
Gentlemen, I'm terribly sorry, but we are out of time. That was a fascinating debate. Hopefully you'll come back and talk to us again very soon. For now, we appreciate you taking the time. Thank you very much.